I want to warn you in advance. This is not going to be a celebration speech. And you might even find some of the context offending. Well, that being said, let's start. I want to start with a little piece of music. And maybe you recognize this music. I know some of you should. This is the overture of Daniel Auber's opera La Muette de Portici, of the well, or the Mute of Portici. When this opera was performed on August 25, 1830, in Brussels, in a theater like this, it led to an uprising, a revolution that led to the founding of an independent Belgian state. Let's go from music to literature. This book, by the American author Harper Lee, published in 1960, revolutionized thinking about racial injustice and inequality in the United States. As this movie, you've probably seen it all, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, a movie by Milos Forman, changed the view and the treatment of psychiatric patients. And you probably all remember what tremendous impact this iconic photo had on the European commitment to the refugees that fled the civil war in Syria. Music, theater, literature, cinematography, photography, all of these arts have the power of social impact. And what about heritage? Museums, monuments and heritage sites, what have we revolutionized over the years? There are museums about revolutions, certainly. But are they revolutionary in the way that they have the impact of Daniel Auber's opera? Isn't it the bare truth, and now for the offending part of my speech, isn't it the bare truth that we are, in fact, scientific or aesthetic islands? Of value, no doubt, but without any substantial connection to the communities in which we act. Are we not mere advertisements and symbols of status for those in power, for our corporate sponsors, for the tourist industry? Have we not turned our backs to the social problems our societies face? And are we not ideologically as empty as this museum on this picture? Well, no. Of course not. I feel some relief. We all have, to some extent, some of the characteristics I mentioned. But when you take a good look at the heritage movement as a whole, you see a lot of social engagement. But these projects are merely local initiatives and don't have the impact of an international bestseller or a movie release. When I attended this Best Inheritance conference last year, I saw some wonderful and inspiring examples of that engagement to the community. Like the Children's Museum of Indianapolis, who choose to be a catalyst for the revitalization of the troubled neighborhood it's located in. The goal of the museum is not only to change the lives of the children and families that visit it, but also of those in the neighborhood. Together with the help of the community and of the community leaders, the museum invests in home improvement, after-school programs, and grants for promising young students. And commitment to the vitality of the community is also what drives the Baksi Museum from Beyburt, Anatolia in Turkey, a region that suffers from high levels of immigration. By stimulating and initiating projects in which modern design and the local textile tradition are combined, the museum offers work to the local women and at the same time contributes to the sustainability of the traditional skills and public memory of the region. And like the Baksi Museum, also the Saurer Museum in Arbon, Switzerland, did a wonderful job in restoring pride in the community's cultural heritage. When the Saurer factory closed after 150 years of production, 6,000 men and women out of a population of 13,000 lost their jobs. And not only that, also their direction in life and their pride. By preserving some of the monumental factory buildings, turn it into a museum with the help of a large group of volunteers, the museum managed to give the community its soul back by rediscovering its history. On another level, that's the last example of last year, the Zanish Liebke Memorial in Riga, Latvia, took the lead in organizing meetings and seminars in which the sensitive issue of the attitude of the Latvians towards Syrian refugees was discussed. This, in the spirit of Zanish Liebke and his family, who saved the lives of more than 80 Jewish people during the Second World War. All these examples show the power heritage can have to the local community. And this power was discovered for the first time by a completely new kind of heritage institution, the Eco Musée, in the 1970s. The paradigm of this Eco Musée movement is that the nearer a museum is to the needs of its users, whose environment, cultural heritage it protects and continues, the better a museum is. Or, in other words, the museum is the community and vice versa. A strong advocate of the social engagement of heritage institutions, he calls them public memory institutions, or PMIs, is Professor Tomislav Zola, founder and director of the Best in Heritage Conference and our host. In his latest book, and it's a difficult title, Mnosophy, no, Mnemosophy, an essay on the science of public memory, he states that social engagement is really the future of the heritage movement and should be one of the primary missions of every PMI. Public memory, he says, doesn't belong to the ones who control the budgets, neither to the curators or the marketeers. It's a common good that should be used for the benefit of society. How? By turning all the knowledge we manage in our institutions into a superior value, a finished product that helps solving problems in the communities. And he calls it wisdom. A product that puts the past into the function of the present. Of course, this is by far means easy. It asks maybe for a change of mind in the heritage movement, a new set of professional standards, training, and a renewal of the science of public memory to support all of this. I can really recommend this essay to you. It makes you think about the essence of our profession. Okay, so far, so good. But isn't there a downside to social engagement? What if the authority that holds the budget for your institution doesn't like you addressing sensitive political issues? What if your sponsors don't like your engagement? And what if you lose part of your audience that has a different opinion on society? Surely, all these risks are real, but they can be met. A lot depends on the position you take as heritage institution. It's better to be a communicator than an agitator. Not to act as the sole owner of the truth, but to act as a facilitator and interpreter of knowledge. In one word, each of us has to find our own way to wisdom. I know this maybe sound a little bit abstract, so let me give you an example. An example from my own museum, the Westfries Museum in Hoorn. And in the first row is also the director of the Fries Museum. And so I come from West Friesland, and that was separated by a big flood from Friesland. So it's a different region with a different culture. And I want to present you the project which was awarded last year during the conference as the most influential project. And the project is called the Coen Case. This is about the statue of Jan Pieterszoon Coen. For over 120 years, this 17th century Governor General of the Dutch East India Company looks out over the central square of the city of Hoorn, where he was born in 1587. In 2011, the statue suddenly became the center of a heated debate. Opponents collected signatures. They want the city council to remove the statue. They consider him a mass murderer, and mass murderers don't deserve statues, is their opinion. To many others, this is taken too far. Hands off our local hero. He may be a crook, but he's still our crook, a city councilman states. The debate touches a raw nerve in Hoorn, the city, as well as in the rest of the country. It raises the question how the Dutch want to deal with the dark pages of their past. along what ethical standards should proclaimed heroes from the past be judged. For weeks, the news dominated the social media, the newspapers, and even it was on national television. Who would have thought Jan Pieterszoon Coen, 17th century icon, a trending topic? Of course, the whole debate offered a great opportunity to the Westfries Museum. The statue is almost on our doorstep, and the museum's ambition is to make the 17th century, also known as the Golden Age, relevant to a contemporary audience. Well, we didn't give it much thought. We immediately changed our exhibition schedule to address the issue. But the question was, in what way? What value could the museum add to the debate, we asked ourselves. Observing the debate, it struck us how strongly it engaged people. Almost everyone had an opinion on the matter. But the public debate was oversimplified by black and white thinking. Jan Pieterszoon Coen was a bad crook or a blameless hero. There was hardly anything in between. While the fascinating thing about historical figures, of course, is that they have so many faces, especially when you look at them from different perspectives. So the museum saw it as its biggest challenge to find a way, an appealing format, to encourage people to create a more well-founded opinion on Coen based on facts and different views. And we found that format, the Coen Case, an exhibition in the form of a trial with Coen as the accused, a real charge. Jan Pieterszoon Coen isn't worthy a statue, it should be taken away, and a case that was clearly structured and presented in the exhibition, like a cold case, with the pros and cons of the charge, supported with a lot of physical evidence, expert witnesses, both for the prosecution and for the defense, and an appealing judge, Maarten van Rossum, a well-known Dutch historian and television personality. And most important of it all, the visitor positioned as a member of the jury, who's expected, like a real jury member, to judge the case, but only after close study of all the evidence, pro and con, and supported by solid arguments. This proved to be a very good and appealing format. It allowed the visitor to develop an opinion in a well-founded and engaging way, with the museum as facilitator that didn't force an opinion on anyone. We see this as an example how to turn knowledge into wisdom, how to put the past into function of the present. The museum also put a lot of effort in communication. The exhibition was supported by a solid promotional campaign. You see there a parody on our poster. It showed Hitler instead of Coen. And it was taken in the exhibition right away. And we also published a magazine, the Coen magazine, a hint to the very popular personal magazines in the Netherlands. And it contained many stories on this fascinating historical figure, known and unknown facts, opinion, and some humor as well, like a column on Coen paraphernalia we sold on eBay. Of course, there was a lot of attention to education as well, and to engaging events like the Story Room project, in which 8 inhabitants of Hoorn told about their special positive or negative ties to Coen. The final result was a project that appealed to the people, that met a need and contributed substantially to the debate. We had almost 10,000 visitors, 3,000 of them school children. We sold more than 1,100 magazines, but most satisfying, we've got over 3,000 votes, many supported by solid arguments. In the end, 2/3 of the museum visitors voted in favor of the statue, for different reasons. The Coen case got the museum a lot of goodwill among citizens and local politicians, as well as great publicity and public attention. The project proved that a museum, although it deals with the past, can be a relevant and lively part of today's society and contribute to the solving of social issues. What happened to Coen, you may wonder? Is he still looking out on the square? Well, he's looking out on the square again, because history has a lot of humor. The bronze cultural icon was knocked off his pedestal by a careless lorry driver just 2 weeks after the city council decided that it could stay in place. And this added a new word to the Dutch vocabulary, koenen. It means have your picture taken on the empty pedestal of the statue. And after, you see here the phone number, I will tell what that is. After the restoration, the statue was given a new and more coherent bilingual information sign that was made by the museum, and it has a QR code that gives access to a permanent website about Coen. And that has all the information the exhibition contained. And it has a telephone number, and you just saw the telephone number. When you call that number, you'll hear, "Hi, this is Coen. I'm glad you called. I'm presently not available, but please leave a message after the beep." Well, let me conclude. We, as heritage institutions, can mean a lot to the community in which we operate. This morning, I saw some inspiring best practices in the field of new media already, and I'm sure we all will see some more the next 2 days. Using our knowledge, talents, our public appeal, our communication skills and creativity, we can turn this into wisdom, not only for the benefit of the community, but also for us as institutions as well, because our support in and our relevance to the community, the very people that pay us, will grow. So, what keeps us from acting? Does the revolution in the heritage movement starts on September the 22nd in Dubrovnik? We're in a theater already. Anyway, let's be inspired by all the projects presented, but most of all, let's engage. To use the words of Tomislav Sola, the world can be made a better place every day by everyone, let alone by the institutions serving the common good. Thank you.